in Java. Today we will discuss multithreading. Now, what is the multithreading program? It contains two or more parts that can run concurrently. Now, each part of such a program is called a thread, and each thread defines a separate path of execution. Therefore, the multithreading is a specialized form of multitasking. Now, there are different terms that we will use. First term is thread. Thread is defined as a path of execution, a collection of statements that execute in a specific order. Now, what is the process? Process is the program that is executing. Now, there are two types of multitasking. One is process-based multitasking. Another one is thread-based multitasking. Now, in case of process-based multitasking, it allows the computer to run two or more programs concurrently. Whereas in case of thread-based multitasking, a single program can perform two or more tasks simultaneously, and each task is known as a thread. Now we will discuss the features of process-based multitasking. Now the processes are heavyweight tasks that require their own address spaces. Inter-process communication is expensive and limited, and the context switching from one process to another is costly. So these are the few features of process-based multitasking. Now next is features of thread-based multitasking. Threads are lightweight, so they share the same address space. The inter-thread communication is inexpensive, and the context switching from one thread to another is cheaper. Now one point that we have to note is multithreading enables to write very efficient programs that makes maximum use of CPU. Now the question arises, why to use multithreading? Now in a single threaded application, one thread of execution must do everything. So if an application has several tasks to perform, those tasks will be performed when the thread can get to them. So that is the disadvantage of a single threaded applications. Now a single task which requires a lot of processing can make the entire application appear to be sluggish or unresponsive. See, if we are having a single threaded application, in that case, when the execution of one thread will be completed, then the turn of the second thread will come. So that then there is a problem. So to overcome that problem, we use multithreading. Now in a multithreading application, each task can be performed by a separate thread. So if one thread is executing a long process, it does not make the entire application wait for it to finish. So multiple tasks are running simultaneously. If a multithreaded application is being executed on a system that has a multiple processors, the operating system executes separate threads simultaneously on separate processors. So the different kinds of application that use multithreading are any kind of application which has distinct tasks which can be performed independently. Any application with a GUI. For example, threads dedicated to the GUI can delegate the processing of user requests to other threads. The GUI remains responsive to the user even when the user's requests are being processed. So any application which requires asynchronous response, that is a multi-threaded application. Network-based applications are ideally suited to multi-threading. So data can arrive from the network at any time. In a single-threaded system, data is queued until the thread can grab the data. So in a multi-threaded system, a thread can be dedicated to listening for data on the network port. When data arrives, the thread reads it immediately and processes it or delegates its processing to another thread. Now the example of multi-threading. So we can take the example of simple web server. In case of web server, it listens to for a request and serves it. So that is the basic purpose of the web server. If web server was not multi-threaded, the request processing would be in a queue. So if multiple users are sending the request, their request to the web server, and if it would be a single-threaded, in that case there will be an increase in response time and also might hang the server if there was a bad request. So by implementing a multi-threaded environment on the web server, it can serve multiple requests simultaneously, thus improving response time. So that is the example of multi-threading. Now how it works? So each thread is given its own context. A thread's context includes virtual registers and its own calling stack. The scheduler, there is a scheduler that decides which thread execute at any given time. The virtual machine may use its own scheduler. Since many operating systems now directly support multi-threading, the virtual machine may use the system's scheduler for scheduling threads. So the scheduler maintains a list of ready threads and list of threads waiting for input. So there can be two queues, one that is running, another one is that is waiting. So each thread has a priority. The scheduler typically schedules between the highest priority threads in the run queue. So a scheduler, the work of scheduler is to maintain the list of ready threads, that means the threads that are running and the threads that are in waiting. So and it threads have, all the threads have their priority. So higher priority threads will be executed first and then the lower priority threads. Now the Java thread model. So in a life cycle of a thread, it goes to different states. So we will discuss those states, those stages in the life cycle of a thread. First stage is born. When a thread is created for the first time, it is referred to as a born thread. So that is the first stage, and it will occur only once in the lifetime of a thread. Second state is runnable, or you can say the ready state. After a newly born thread is started, the thread becomes runnable and enters the queue of its respective priority. So after the thread is born, it comes to the ready state. Then third stage is running. If the thread scheduler grants permission to a thread, then it will start running. So that means from ready state, it will come to the running state. Now the fourth stage is blocked. Now a thread can become blocked, which occurs when multiple threads are synchronizing on the same data and need to take turns. A blocked thread is not running, nor it's runnable. So we have to keep in mind, then if all the threads wants to work on the same set of block, and that is synchronized. Synchronization means only one thread can enter into that particular block at a time. So all the other threads have to wait. So that is called the blocked state, and in that case, it is not that thread is not in the running state, nor it is in the runnable state. So not this will not be in the ready state as well as not in the running state. So other blocked states are, a thread can become blocked for other reasons also. For example, a thread can invoke the wait method on an object within blocks the thread until notify is invoked on the same object. So sometimes it may happen that one block is inside the synchronized block and it generates a wait message to all other threads. In that case, all the threads have to wait until the thread that has generated the waiting message sends a notify message. So that is the one state of the blocked thread. A thread can call the join method and wait for another thread to finish. So there is another method, join method is there. If a thread has invoked the join method, that means it will wait for another thread to finish and then it will finish its execution. Now the fifth state is dead state, or you can say the finished state. A thread that runs to completion is referred to as a dead thread. The term dead is used because it cannot be started again. So that is the last stage of the thread, and it will not recycle itself. It will not go to other stages. And you can see here, this is the life cycle of the thread state diagram. When the new thread is created, that is a new thread, and that is in the born state. So thread has been created. Then by calling the start method, it will come to the ready state. That means it is ready to run. Now from this state, it will go to the running state. That means it is performing its execution. Now from the running state, it can go again to the ready state, or it can wait for the other thread to finish, or it can wait for the timeout, or it can wait for to be notified. Or after running to completion, it can come to the finished state. Now there are number of methods that are there in Java that are used for completing this cycle, like life cycle of the thread. So you can see here, this is a start thread, start method, yield, interrupt, run, join, sleep, wait, run. So there are different methods that you can use for implementing the threads. Now, very important point, that is the thread priority. Now, all the threads that you are defining in your program, they all have a priority. So, these priorities are actually the integer terms. As you can see here, some constants and their integer values are given. Even by default, all the threads have a priority 5. That is the norm priority. And minimum priority is 1 and maximum priority is 10. So, the threads have a priority between 1 and 10. And by default, if you are not specifying the priority, that it will take the priority as 5. Now each thread is assigned a default priority of thread, that's wanted. The priority of the main thread is, that is the norm priority. Now we can reset the priority by using the set priority method, and in that we can pass the integer value for the priority. Now all the Java programs that we have created or implemented in the last few lectures, they have one thread that is known as a main thread. So as you can see here, there is a thread E class, and in that there is a main method, and in the main method we have created a thread T instance of class thread, that is a inbuilt class that we can use to create a thread. And thread dot current thread, it is a reference to the current thread, that means it is referring to the main method. Now we are printing the value of T, so it will give you the reference of this main thread method. Then we are changing the name. Currently the name of the thread is main. Now we want to set the name as new main. So we can print here. So it will print the next time with the new name. And then we are trying to print the value of I, and we have used one method, that is sleep method, and we are passing the delay period in milliseconds. So it is 1000 milliseconds, that means it will sleep for 1 second, and then it will be executed. So it will print 0 to 4 and after a gap of 1000 milliseconds. And this sleep method can cause an interrupt exception, so we have used the cache block. So when we will execute this program, we will have this output. So first we are displaying the value of T. So in that case the name of the thread is main, and its priority is 5, and it is inside the main method. Now second time when we have set the name of the method as new main, so it is referring to new main, priority is 5, and it is inside the main method, and it is printing from 0 to 4 after a gap of 1000 milliseconds. So every program has a thread. So we have already created the program related to thread. Now how to create a thread? There are two methods of creating a thread. One is it can be created either by implementing the runnable interface that is available, or we can extend the thread class, that is a unit class itself. Now which method is better and why have to use that method? See, when we are using the thread class, as we already know that in case of inheritance, a class can extend only one class, right? So a class can have only one superclass. So if we are extending the thread class with the extending the thread class, so we cannot extend any other class. We cannot add the properties. We cannot use the properties of other classes. So that is a drawback of creating a thread by extending the thread class. Now second method is by implementing the runnable interface. So we can implement as a number of interfaces when we are implementing the runnable class, and we can also extend another class. So that is written here. It is more preferred to implement the runnable interface so that we can extend properties from other classes. Now how to create a thread by using runnable interface? Now one point that we have to note is we have to implement the run method, which is the starting point for a thread execution, as we have already seen in the state diagram of the thread. So there is a class dthread that is implementing the runAVAR interface, and we have a variable t of type thread. That is an inbuilt class. Now in the constructor, we are creating a instance of that class. T is an instance, and we are passing the reference of this class, and we are passing the name. So we are passing the reference of the class and implementing the runAVAR interface, and name of the thread is d1. So now we have created, now thread is born, now we have to it has to come to the ready state. So t dot start, it will come to the ready state, and when this statement will be executed, automatically run method is called. So in run method is invoked, and the statement inside the run method will be executed. That means the thread is in runAVAR state. So to invoke the run method, we have to use the start method. That means t dot start. Now it will start the run method. Now in the run method, we are having we want to print the value of i, that is the character, till f, and then it will print the characters after 500 milliseconds. Every character will be printed after 500 milliseconds. And as I already told you that sleep-mask can generate an interrupted exception, so we have used the try and catch block. Now, in the thread e class, we have a main method, and we are calling the constructor. We are creating an object of the dthread class in which the thread has been generated. So the system order, it will print main thread running for. Now in this we are displaying 0 to 4, and there is a thread dot sleep method. Now it we must know that what should be the execution. Now you can see here, this is the output. First is a thread name, priority is 5, and it is inside the main method, and then it will print the new method, priority is 5, right? So it is printing this one. So when the program is executed, every time when you execute the multi-threaded program, it will generate different results. So it depends how much time a thread will get to execute. Now next method is creating a thread by extending the thread class. So as you can see here, we have a class dthread that is extending the thread class. We have a name variable here. Inside the constructor, we are calling the super constructor. That means we are calling the constructor of the super class, that is the thread class. And then we are starting the method. So in this particular case, we can directly use the start method without creating an instance of thread class, because this class is directly extending the thread class. So when this statement is executed, run method will be executed automatically, and it will print the values from 0 to 5. And it will generate the random numbers, and this is the thread dot sleep method. So, and in the main method, we are generating the instance of dthread class, and then we are printing the value of 0 to 4. So it will print this output. Now the methods that are there in thread class, they are run. So run method is the entry point for the thread. Then there is a start method that start a thread by calling its run method. So when the start method is called, it will automatically invoke the run method. Sleep method is used to suspend the thread for a period of time. It will take the time period in milliseconds. Is alive, it will return a boolean value. It will return true if the thread is still running. That means the thread is alive. Then the join method is used for wait for a thread to terminate. Now creating multiple threads. So in the previous examples, we were having two threads. One was a main thread. Another one we have created either by implementing the thread class, by implementing the runAVAR interface, or by extending the thread class. Now if one wish to create multiple threads, one could simply create multiple instances of the thread class and send each object a start message. So each instance would create its own thread object. So now the question arises, is there a maximum number of threads which can be created? So we can create any number of threads. So there is no maximum limit in Java. If the virtual machine is delegating threads to the operating system, then this is platform independent, platform dependent. So a good rule of thumb for maximum thread count is to allow 2 MB of RAM for each thread. So that is the restriction that we should allocate 2 MB of RAM for each thread, so that the program will execute smoothly. So although threads share the same memory space, this can be a reasonable estimate of how many threads your machine can handle. So it depends on the size of the RAM. So this is an example of the race car. The objective of this program is to create multiple threads. So I have taken this example of race car. Suppose we have 5 cars. Now we have to find out which car will finish the race first. So we have to give the standing to each car. So for that, race car is extending the thread class int finish. Finish will give you the whether the car has reached first, second, third, fourth, or fifth. So standing in K, then the race car constructor. So initially finish is 5 and name is N. So in the run method we have given 1 to finish and system.out.println name of the car, and then it is randomly generating the sleep period, that is the time period, by using the random method. And then we are printing that the car has finished at this position. Now in the main method we have created an array of a string type, and we have given the names to the cars, and then we have created an array R of race car class. Then first we have to create 5 threads for 5 cars, so that's why we have written this statement. And then we have to assign the name to each car. Then we have to start each and every thread of the car, race car. So the start method is there, and then we are finding from time to time whether that thread is alive or not. So for that we are using isAlive method. Then we have used the join method. So join method tells to wait until another thread's finished. So we have already told you that wait for a thread to terminate. So if you have used the join method, that means this thread will wait until other thread finish. And again we are printing after coming out from the try and catch block, we are finding whether the thread is alive or not. So you can see the output here. So every time when we'll execute this program, it will generate different output, as it depends on the CPU time, whether that CPU is available for that thread or not. So every time the output will be different. Now concurrent access to data. Now as those who are familiar with the databases, we can understand this process, that the concurrent access to data can lead to data integrity problems. Now data integrity problems means for example, we have an account in the bank, and at the same time one person is withdrawing the money from that account, and at the same time the other person is trying to deposit the amount to that account. So suppose in that case they are doing these two transactions concurrently. So in that case they will have the inconsistent data. So that is the problem. So specifically, if two sources attempt to update the same data at the same time, the result of the data can be undefined. So we will not know the exact result. So the outcome is determined by how the scheduler schedules the two sources. Since the scheduler activities cannot be predicted, the outcome cannot be predictive. So that is the problem. So database deals with this mechanism through locking. See, when there is an inconsistency in the data, so we need some mechanism so that everybody gets the updated data. So the locking is a procedure. If a source is going to update a table or record, it can log the table or record until such time that the data has been successfully updated. That means anybody who is updating the data at that time, nobody can update that record at the same time. So that is called logging. So while logged, all access is blocked except to the source which holds the log. So Java has the equivalent mechanism and it is called synchronization. So in case of Java, we use synchronize keyword for this concurrent access to data. Now the synchronization. In Java, every object has a lock. So to obtain a lock, you must synchronize with the object. So that is the condition that is required. The simplest way to use synchronization is by declaring one or more methods to be synchronized. When a synchronized method is invoked, the calling thread attempts to obtain the lock on the object. And if it cannot obtain the lock, the thread goes to sleep until the lock becomes available. So once the lock is obtained, no other thread can obtain the lock until it is released. So that is the synchronized method terminates. So when a thread is within the synchronized method, it knows that no other synchronized method can be invoked by any other thread. So therefore, it is within the synchronized method that critical data is updated. So suppose in case of the account class, we require that when one person is doing any transaction in that particular account, no other person can do the transaction. So what we will do, we will make the deposit method and the withdraw method as synchronized. That means if one person is depositing the amount in that particular account, no other person can do any type of transaction until the first transaction is completed. So that is the concept of synchronization. Now providing thread safe access to data. So if an object contains data which may be updated from multiple thread sources, the object should be implemented in a thread safe manner. So all access to critical data should only be provided through synchronized methods. So we will use the synchronization concept when we have the critical data. That means the data that is very important and we need that data in a consistent form. So in this way we are guaranteed that the data will be updated by only one thread at a time. Now how to provide the thread safe access to data? As you can see here, we have a class saving account. As I have already told you, in the saving account we have two methods. One is withdraw method, that is used for withdrawing the money from the account. Another one is deposit method, that is used for depositing the amount into the account. So what we have done, there is a private variable balance. We have made the both the methods, withdraw and deposit, as synchronized. This is the keyword. So what we need, we want that if one thread is inside, one thread is doing the updations in this method, no other thread can enter into that method to make that data inconsistent. So that's why we have declared this method as synchronized. So if amount is greater than 0.0 and amount is less than balance, so balance will be updated. And in case of deposit, if amount is there greater than 0, so we can deposit the amount. So that is the concept of synchronization. Now thread safety performance issues. Now however, there is an overhead associated with synchronization. Many threads may be waiting to gain access to one of the object synchronized methods. So the object remains locked as long as thread is within a synchronized method. So that is the restriction. When one thread is inside the synchronized method, another thread cannot enter. So it has to wait for that. So method should be kept as short as possible. Now another solution is to provide synchronization on a block of code instead of entire method. See, as I have already told you that if one method is has entered into the synchronized method, no other thread can enter into that synchronized method. So it has to wait. It may or that synchronized method may or may not have some other instructions. So the solution to this is why not to make the only those set That is another solution. So another solution is to provide synchronization of block of code instead of the entire method, so that all the threads can enter into that method, but the thread only one thread can enter into the synchronized block. So in this case, the object's lock is only held for the time that the thread is within the block. So the set of statements will be reduced because we are making a few set of statements synchronized one. So other threads can work on other statements at that time. So the intent is that we only lock the region of the code which requires access to the critical data. So any other code within the method can occur without the lock. So in high load situations where multiple threads are attempting to access critical data, this is by far a much better implementation. So that is the advantage. You can see here, this is the example of the same example, saving account class. In the previous example, we were making the method as synchronized, but in this particular case, what we have done, we have not made the withdraw method or the deposit method as synchronized, but we have made the block synchronized, and in that block in which balance has been updated. So you can see here, this is a withdraw method, and we are checking whether it is less than 0. It has to throw the illegal argument exception, and then the thread will come to the synchronized block, and here we are checking the balance and we are updating the balance. So this set of statement is critical, so that's why we have put this set of statements into the synchronized block, and this we are passing this to this. So it is passing to the current thread. So once the thread has been entered into this block, no other thread can enter into this block. So same is the case for deposit. We have made a block in which the balance, where we are updating the balance information, that statement has been kept in the synchronized block. So there are two methods, either to make the method synchronized or either to make a block synchronized. So it depends on the requirement of the problem.